presentation that we'll be having for the today's session. Thank you very much for the invitation. As always, a very good feeling to be with TaxCan for all the webinars and the articles and the initiatives that they have for tax, direct tax, income tax, indirect tax, GST, and even the corporate laws. Today's session that I'll be taking on is on the two proposed amendments. They are not yet implemented, but we'll be discussing something, the proposed amendments. The reason of discussing proposed amendments is quite important because we get to know what the regulators are going to amend in the near future. And that is very important for us as professionals to know that what are the amendments that may come up in 6 months or 12 months or maybe 18 months down the line, because it helps us in strategizing proper strategies for the companies or proper corporate actions for the companies from the perspective of company law or securities law. And this is quite relevant for the participants, whether as students, because if there is a student of CS executive or CA executive, then he would be having this in his CA or CS foundation final exam. And if it is a professional, then the learning is an ongoing process and we have to keep on learning for our own clients, which we will be having. I'll just share the screen and start with the presentation today. Yeah, I think the screen would be visible, or it would be visible now.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not a bit well, as in some cough, but not a problem at all. Nothing to worry about COVID. So I may be drinking water in between. Okay, great. So basically we have this presentation with the TaxCan, the first part. So first part is with respect to the promoters and promoters group that the SEBI is going to change. Now, I cannot see the audience. So I am not very familiar with who is a chartered accountant or a company secretary, but broadly, obviously, or a student. So to give some background, quick background of this promoters and promoters group, right? These two concepts of promoters and promoter group is basically in quite a few regulations of SEBI, which is SEBI issue of capital and disclosure requirements, or it could be in SEBI takeover code, or it could be in SEBI PIT regulation, that is prohibition of insider trading regulation, or it could be maybe a pro regulation with respect to prohibition of fraudulent trade practices, right? So there are multiple regulations where there is a reference of promoter and promoter group, right? Even listing regulation has got that reference. Now, what is the source of this? The source of these two concepts is basically in SEBI ICDR regulation, right? That is issue of capital and disclosure requirement regulation. In these regulations, we have a reference of these two concepts that they will be referred to in the, they have defined these two. So we will come to the definition also, but that is where it is. When we say a promoter in India or anywhere, it is understood that he's either started a company or he has floated an IPO for the company, right? So that is how it is. Like, for example, when we say Infosys, by default, we have got 4 to 5 names who are the promoters of the company. When it is Wipro, we have got Mr. Azim Premji and his family as the promoters. When we have Bajaj Auto, we have got, the Bajaj family as the promoters. Or when we have got Reliance Industries, it's the Ambani family. So broadly, a company is always linked to its promoters most of the times, right? But there are quite a few companies. Now that's the trend that is coming up in India. And therefore, this amendment has been introduced because in certain companies, the promoter is not identifiable. Okay, this is a very interesting aspect. You have a company, but you don't have a promoter family or a promoter group per se. Everybody is holding some 10%, 12%, 12% shareholding in the company. And that's how the company shareholding is there. You may have some 8-10 shareholders and that's it. obviously you would be having somebody in that domain, but that he would have raised funds. And therefore, since he has raised funds, the person who is giving funds may not have the domain knowledge. And the person who is receiving funds may not have the funds. Therefore, he's going to the investor. So that's where, you know, we have got an investor concept and a promoter concept. And you can say a person who is a domain expert, right? That's the place where SEBI is coming up and why these regulations are amended. So this is, since it is all interlinked, I thought of just interlinking through a particular, you can say a chart. So before we discuss promoter or promoter group, it is important to understand the meaning of control. And this is a very debated aspect under the securities law. What is control? Because basically this definition is an inclusive definition. Interestingly, this definition is not part of any regulation other than takeover code. It's only in takeover code that control is defined. And when you have got this definition of control, it's been referred to in other regulations. Like for example, if you go to the SEBI listing regulation, SEBI listing regulation says go to the takeover code. You go to the PIT regulation, it says go to the takeover. Go to ICDR, ICDR says go to the takeover. So that is the basic place where the control is defined. Okay, this is very important to understand promoters. Therefore, I'm discussing control and then going to promoters. And again, to amend the definition of control, SEBI had introduced a concept paper or a consultation paper in the year 2017, where they had introduced a bright line test for the, you know, for the purpose of control. Okay, anyways, we'll come to this. So control includes a right to appoint majority of directors. So director, that is, you know, control over the management is one. Controlling the management or policy decisions exercisable by the person, either individually or in concert, including by way of a shareholding or management rights. So, you know, you may have an access to the management, you may have an access to the shareholders. As an owner, you can have an access. And if you're controlling either of them, then it will be said that you are control. If you are there by way of, you know, it is a target company or a director of a target company shall not be considered for the purpose. So it's just an exception for the purpose of takeover. So broadly, it is an inclusive definition. It is a very wide definition per se. It includes a right to appoint majority directors and also control the management. And so there are quite a few things. It's not simple. Like having control over the policy decision. Like for example, how many employees should be there? What should be the hierarchy? What should be the internal controls? How should the sales and marketing take place? These are all policy decisions. Having control on this is also having control, right? Having control in the management, like which plan to strategize and how to recruit, who to recruit, that is also part of management. So that is also quite different. And it also includes by way of shareholding and management rights, either by shareholders agreement or voting agreement or in any other manner. So very wide definition of control. And in addition to that, it says that it should be, it is an inclusive definition, right? So that's how the definition it is. But this definition is applicable to, as I said, anything under the securities law, wherever it has referred that the definition of control as referred to in the takeover code. Okay, I'll just come to the definition of promoter. So promoters have been defined, as I said, in ICDR. Okay. Now, when it comes to ICDR definition, when it comes to the definition under the takeover code, when they say that there is a reference of promoter group, they say, okay, go to ICDR. When you have got a definition in PIT regulation, that is prohibition of insider trading, they say go to ICDR regulation. When you have got something in the LODR, they say check the definition in ICDR. So ICDR becomes the basic definition to understand promoters and promoters group under most of the securities law. Okay. And why ICDR? Because that's the time a person who is a promoter of an unlisted company becomes a promoter of a listed company, because ICDR is all about issues, rights issue, public issue, further public issue, or initial public offer, or you know, different kind of issues, preferential allotment, private placement, and quite a few IBs. It is all about that. So if you come to the definition of promoters, there are three ways a person can be a promoter, and internally there are few. So totally there could be 5 to 6 ways in which a person can be a promoter. First is that his name is there in the offer document, like RHP, or you can say DRHP, right? Take an example of Zomato. Like presently Zomato is filed a DRHP with the SEBI. Now in that they have mentioned the person as a promoter. Who are the promoters? If at all they have mentioned the promoters, then they will be called as the promoter for the company henceforth. Like once the company comes up with an IPO, it issues shares, it gets listed, then promoters and promoters group will be the group, maybe only the promoters will be defined, and the responsibility will be there on the concerned person. So offer document is one, DRHP. Okay. Second is that there is a reference in the annual return, which is in the first point. Then it says it has got control over the affairs. Now, this is where I was referring, or I was emphasizing on the definition of control. That who has got control over the affairs over the issuer. Now, since this is a definition in ICDR, there is a reference of issuer and not company. This control can be direct or indirect, whether as a shareholder or whether as a director. So that is the way in which the control is there in a company. And then the third point is, a person who has on whose advice, directions, instructions, the board of the company, that is the issuer, is accustomed to act. So this is broadly an UK English or UK company law based concept, that of the shadow directors, that, you know, the people sitting on the board are just for the sake of being on the board. But the person who is running the company is not on the board. He's sitting behind, or he's not on the board, but he's giving instructions. And the board who is there formally just takes the decision, right? So that is, you can say, a shadow director. Similarly, it says a person who is giving instructions, directions, and the directors are accustomed to act. Then the person who is going and giving instructions will be called as the, you can say, the promoter of the company. So that is how the definition of promoter is. It may look very simple on the face of it, but when it comes to the practical implementation and identifying who is a promoter and who is not a promoter, this becomes a very challenging aspect. Now, I'll give one or two examples where the definition of promoter is referred to. Like when it comes to the SEBI takeover code, there is a requirement of, there is a segregation of promoter shareholding and non-promoter shareholding. That is where the definition of promoter is important. Okay. Then we have got a concept in the SEBI listing regulations of reclassifying the promoter. Like maybe I had signed the DRHP of Infosys long back in, say, 1995, maybe whenever the company came up with an IPO, I'm not aware, but somewhere at that point of time. But now I'm not associated with the company either as a promoter, director, anything. I want to not be associated with that company for my personal reasons. I just want to be adequate, or I'm fully, I'm happy with what I have right now, and I have retired. So I don't want to be associated. So my question over here is that, can I say that I don't want to be the promoter? Answer over here is yes, you can be, but you need to reclassify as a promoter. That is where it is required. Okay. So that is part of, okay. So therefore, that is one more part. Under PIT regulations also, there is a reference with respect to the obligation of promoters and promoter group that they need to make certain disclosures. So the concept of promoters is not only for ICDR. It has got universal application when it comes to securities law, right? Even like taking an example, like if a company has not complied with the provisions of certain listing regulations, then the company, the promoters, the shares of the promoters are freezed for a certain point of time. if at all there is a non-compliance and SEBI has passed an order, and in that order they can say that the promoter should, like, typical example is that company has not complied with the minimum public shareholding norms. In case there is a reference of freezing of promoters' shares. There is also one, I'll give one more reference. I'm just trying to make this concept of promoters, not only restricted to ICDR. Therefore, I'm giving so much of examples. Like under the SEBI LODR, there is a requirement that all the shares of the promoter should be in DMAT form. For that, you need to first identify who are the promoters. Then you need to identify who are under the promoters group. And then you need to DMAT their shares in the particular format. In certain resolutions, promoters are prohibited from voting on the resolution. Like, we will be coming to the next part of it, which is the independent directors. So promoters are restricted is what is proposed in that part. So that is one more important aspect to it. Okay. Okay. So this is about the promoters. I hope this much is adequate for the purpose of explanation. Yeah, I'll just take all the questions. Maybe what we can do is, after we are done with ICDR, we may have a short question answer, and then we may go to independent directors, or we can have all questions collectively for all the both the consultation papers. Okay, then we have promoters group. Okay, now this promoters group is something like, my main activity, like, or I'm the main person in the family, and my family members are promoters group. Like, giving you just an example, my family members are not interested in my business, but just because they are related to me, they become part of my group, right? So they cannot say that, they are not related to me or anything like that, since they are family members. Or it may happen that I am holding certain shares in another company, or I am controlling other companies. They also become promoter group, right? So the net of promoters gets increased over a period of time, right? So promoters group includes promoter. It includes immediate relative of a promoter, that if a promoter is a person or an individual person, or if a promoter is a body corporate, like, for example, just an example I'm saying, I may be wrong, but just an example. You have got one company as HDFC Bank Limited, and its parent company is a private company, HDFC Holdings Private Limited. Then that is a private company. Then somebody would be holding shares, or that HDFC Holding Private Limited would be holding shares in few other 10, 15 companies. Then there is a reference to that. Now there could be holding company, subsidiary company of HDFC Holdings Private Limited. So there could be quite a few people under the concept of if a promoter is a body corporate, okay? That is one aspect. If a promoter is an individual, like, always you can able to identify, there is no company in between. There is directly an individual holding shares in a listed company. Then I will be an individual, and therefore anybody. Now it may happen that there is a provision. This is quite elaborate. I have not put it in that form, but here it says that if there is an individual, then if I am holding, say, 60% of a company, say a private company or a public company, or anything beyond 20%, that becomes part of the promoter group, right? So therefore, that is how it is. So the concept of promoter group, it already includes promoter, right? And why all understanding all this is important is because SEBI is trying to amend some provisions with respect to disclosures and, some obligations of promoters, and therefore understanding all this is very important, right? So you need to identify. And when I'm coming to this concept of promoter as a body corporate, promoter as an individual, there are 3-4 points below it. For example, an associate company of a holding company will be a promoter group company, right? Like, it could be a complex structure, it could be a very simple structure, right? But that's how the businesses are there in India, right? And we also need to understand that businesses, or the way in which the business is done in India right now, is very different the way in which the business was done in 1991. Now, I'm not saying, when I say business, it is actually business in the form of doing business of a company, but I'm saying the way in which funds are raised, the way in which investors are communicated, the way in which the promoters' importance is reducing a bit, and the concept of investors is increasing a bit, and therefore all these regulations are proposed to be amended. Okay. Yeah, now we come to the actual proposed amendments. This is just a summary of it, but this is more than sufficient for understanding what the exact amendments are, right? There is now, we are now not focusing on anything else other than ICDR, right? Now, to give you an example, if you take an example of LIC, or you take an example of any, say, BPCL, if any or any of the unlisted public companies, which is a PSU, which is a public sector company. Now, if government wants to only do offer for sale, that is only sell the shares in the market, like from they want to reduce the shareholding from 100% to 52%. They want to reduce 48%. Now, in that case, they will come only with an IPO with an offer for sale. If that is the case, then there could be some other criteria for promoters holding, right? Now, earlier, this promoter's contribution. Earlier, what used to happen, like a very, not a good example, but this used to happen, that promoters used to raise money in India, like thousands of crores or hundreds of crores, they used to raise money, and they used to run away from the company. So we had a concept of fly-by-night promoters, okay? Now, therefore, they introduced a concept of promoter's contribution, that if you are raising 100 rupees from the market, first have your own 20 rupees, then you raise the 80 rupees. So that is what we call it as skin in the game, right? So SEBI is changing this if you are coming up with an OFS. If it is only with an OFS or, you know, financing for other than capital expenditure project, then the minimum promoter's contribution should be locked in only for 1 year. Obviously, because he's there with the company. Right, means he's not going to run away, which was the case long back in 1985 or 1990 or 1995 till then, till that point of time, or maybe till 2000 also. Right. Now, the shares by a promoter shall be exempt from the lock-in requirement of 6 months from the date of allotment. So, there is a requirement that they remain under the lock-in period for a period of 3 years, but there is a proposed amendment to that. Promoter is holding in excess. Suppose a promoter is required to hold only 20% of the post-issue capital, but he's holding suppose 30-40%. Then presently he's required to hold it. The excess is there locked in for a period of say 1 year, but now the SEBI proposes that let's reduce and make it 6 months. So this is fine tuning which SEBI is proposing in its consultation paper, right? The entire pre-issue capital held by the person other than the promoter shall be locked in for a period of 6 months. Like it can be an investor, like an investor who is associated with the company, his capital may be locked in for a certain period of time. So that is how SEBI is proposing. This is only one part of it, but that is how the amendments have been proposed in this particular lock-in period, specifically in relation to the promoters or not promoters group, but only promoters till now. Yeah, this is the place where they are proposing to introduce the changes in the promoters group. So just going back to the PPT quickly. Now, there is a reference over here if a promoter is a body corporate. Under that, there are several points, like 3-4 points. In one of the points, they are saying that, okay, these companies or these entities should not be considered for the purpose of being a body corporate or being a part of the promoter group. So they are trying to eliminate certain entities, right, with respect to the promoter group. Now, but they're also saying that if at all required, let's see, maybe we can disclose in some other manner, but certain part of promoters group where a person or where a promoter is in the form of a body corporate, that is the place where they are proposing to, you know, change that part with respect to the promoters group. Because practically, if you see, suppose there are say four promoters, right? And considering their relatives, immediate relatives, their promoter entities and their investments and any entity in which they're holding more than 20%, these number of entities practically go more than 40 to 50 entities, right? Of which very few have got control over the listed entity. When I say control, I say in a very wider manner that they have some say in the company. So therefore, from that perspective, they are saying that, okay, let's reduce the promoter group, but let's keep some obligation maybe at a later point of time. Yeah. Again, with respect to group companies. Now, what has happened is SEBI, in some regulation of ICDR, has said that these are group companies. And these group companies should be referred to, and they should be disclosed in the financial statements and as well as in the DRHP, that is the draft rendering prospectus. Now, what SEBI is saying, considering the information explosion for the readers, they are saying that, okay, let's reduce all this to some extent, and let's bring it up to only a limited part. So they are saying that only names and registered office of all the group companies should be disclosed, and all other part with respect to the financials of the top listed companies, litigation, which is presently being disclosed in the DRHP, be done away. However, the listed company or the company which is proposed to get listed may disclose it. So the purpose is that you disclose all this, but not in the main prospectus. You can disclose it on the website. I feel this is a move which may affect the investor sentiment over a period of time. The reason is because there are analysts who go through the prospectus very thoroughly, and their analysis may be affected, right? There are quite a few companies in India which do the business not independently as a listed company, but through its subsidiary companies. And there could be litigation which are pending on the subsidiary companies, and the holding company may be absolutely clean or may be clean to some extent. So with respect to this point, I'm not personally comfortable with this kind of amendment, but let's see. We still have time to submit the, our inputs to the SEBI. So let's see that maybe something is tweaked on this particular proposed amendments. But this is a very crucial amendment from the perspective of drafting a prospectus or including and not including. Here also, as a professional, we should be aware of what is material and what is not material, because there are quite a few judgments on the materiality, right? And SEBI is of the view broadly that whatever is material, include in the prospectus. Okay. Now, what is it? It may happen that it is something material for the other entity, but may not be material for the main entity, which is going to raise funds. Is it required to be disclosed? So this materiality concept is a very interesting aspect. I'll just touch upon the concept of materiality because it's important for the professionals. The concept of materiality under the PIT is something else. The concept of materiality under the SEBI listing regulation is something else. And materiality under the ICDR is something else. Now, when I say something else, the parameters are different, right? Firstly, there is no parameter, but if at all there is a parameter, there could be a different parameter, right? And there are quite a few judgments on this materiality. And maybe I would like to discuss with you all sometime on this aspect also on materiality. Because if you go under the LODR, listing regulation, under a particular regulation, you have to draft even a materiality policy. Then certain events are by default material. Certain events by default are not material. Or they may be material depending on what the directors take a call. Okay. And then there are parameters on how you take a call. So it is a very big concept. Maybe it is ultimately just disclosure of information, but it is a very big concept. Right. And under the provisions of SEBI PIT regulation, that is the prohibition of insider trading regulation, we have got this concept of materiality, which is linked to the concept of UPSI, that is unpublished price sensitive information. So a lot of case laws that are coming up on this concept, which is relevant for us as professionals. Okay. So there is one more aspect with respect to this is a very critical aspect. Maybe the last part of the suggestion, it says that the SEBI is proposing that the existing concept of promoter and promoters group should be shifted to person in control or controlling shareholders or person acting in concert. This is a very interesting aspect because it is going to change the entire scenario for securities law, the entire regulatory framework, the adjudication framework, the penalizing framework, or maybe even the liability framework when it comes to the concept where they are going from the promoter or promoter group to a person in control, right? And therefore, again, the concept of control is important. Okay, so maybe SEBI would have to define this concept person in control or controlling shareholders. Now, why this is come? Because what SEBI has observed, and even probably what we have been observing, that in the recent times, there are not many family-owned companies which are coming in the market to raise funds. Okay, there are many companies where you have got already an investor in that company, and that investor wants to take an exit from that company. Okay, and therefore SEBI is moving from the concept of promoters to the concept of person in control. And generally, when you are having a person in control, the investor, through its agreement, shareholders agreement, or the articles of association, or maybe any other understanding that he may have with the company, is having control over the company in some manner. Therefore, they are referring to the person in control. This is all my rational and my understanding of what all this is all about. But you can say in the recent times, this has been the trend, and therefore this kind of proposal has been made. Interestingly, take an example. Person in control in the case of government companies, PSUs, it is very, very difficult to identify this, right? Person in control. So SEBI would require some different parameter for that. It could be a company which is a family-owned company, but over a period of time, investors have come in and the family shareholding has reduced. But again, then the question would be, what is the concept of person in control over there? Okay. And it could be, you know, there could be various combinations in which the company has raised funds, and therefore there is a reference of a promoter or a person in control. This will require a lot of deliberation. Something in relation to the control, maybe I may not discuss that in detail now, but I would like to discuss that sometime later, is one discussion which SAT had introduced in one of its judgments in Shubhkam Ventures India Private Limited versus SEBI. It is a very short judgment. I'm not sure if it is of 2010, but I think so it is of 2010. I wanted to make a part of this particular presentation, but due to shortage of time for today's presentation, or I have many things to present today, I have not included that in the presentation. But that is one very interesting judgment, hardly 13-14 page judgment, or the SEBI SAT order, where that concept of control is discussed. The matter had been to the Supreme Court. But anyways, what I want to say at this particular point of time, in entire concert year, the most important part is with respect to the promoters, which they will be now referred to as, which they may be referred to as person in control. We will quickly come to the framework, and then we may come to the concept of all the question answers for the participants. It is not new for us. It's been there for minimum 7 years under the Companies Act, and maybe around 20-21 years under the SEBI, under the listing agreement and then the regulation. Okay, now just take this concept, like why I considered these two topics. If you say I discuss about promoters in the earlier slide, and I'm discussing about 75% of the company. Okay. And when I come to the concept of independent directors, discuss 25% of the company. And therefore, these two consultation papers are very important because they are practically changing the way in which listed companies are going to work. Whether in the form of a independent directors audit committee, NRC, or any other committee, or as a promoter or promoter shareholding, or disclosures that are to be made, responsibilities, liabilities in the company. Yeah. So purpose of having independent directors, I may tell it theoretically, practically in one or two cases it may change, but the purpose is that the independent directors brings some independence. The independent director brings some independence in the company's decision making. The board of directors, if it is a promoter driven company, most of the decisions will be pro promoters, and that is what the regulators don't want. They want a balanced decision in favor of the stakeholders and in the favor of the promoters, both balanced, right? That is how they want it. Therefore, they introduced a concept of independent directors, and then they kept on evolving and amending the provisions. We have provisions under section 149, subsection 6 of the Companies Act with respect to the independent director. A few other regulations, there is a reference of independent directors. Responsibility of independent directors is not there specifically, but there is a reference in the audit committee, remuneration committee, risk management committee. There are quite a few committees that are formed, and there are terms of what the committee needs to do. So the responsibility of the independent directors comes from these concepts or these committees that are formed. Liability, we will come to that point, or probably we may just come to that point quickly. That is defining points of the liabilities of directors. What it says is, notwithstanding anything contained in this act, an independent director, non-executive director, not being a promoter or KMP, shall be liable. This is a very important aspect. It creates an exception for non-executive and independent director who are obviously not KMPs, key managerial personnel. They shall not be liable, or they shall be liable, means they shall be liable only in respect of omission or commission by the correct person, that independent director's knowledge, or which is attributable through the board processes, which is a very important aspect, and his consent or connivance, or where he has not acted diligently. So exercising diligence is a very important aspect when it comes to the liability. And therefore, there are quite a few cases where this section 149 subsection 12 has been tested by SEBI, SAT, company law, NCLT, in quite a few judgments, that who will be liable and who will not be liable. Therefore, in liabilities of, if we go theoretically, it is limited. Liability of independent director is limited only if he exercises diligence, only if he exercises, he restricts from participating in certain decision making. He ensures that it is minutes, that he goes through the agenda minutes, and then he comes to a point where he can say or give his own view with respect to the particular decision taken by the company. So very critical aspect, I feel, with respect to the independent director's liability. And there are at least, as far as I understand, around 6 to 8 or maybe 10 cases on this particular point in the recent times with respect to the liability of the independent directors. Like, difficult for me to take it now, therefore not considering. Okay, now what SEBI is proposing is that they are proposing certain tweaks or certain changes to the definition of independent directors. What they are saying, that KMPs and relatives of KMP or employees of the promoter group cannot be independent directors. And there is a requirement that 3 years cooling period should be complete. Now, if we see section 149, there is already a reference of this kind of amendment, which says that himself, he shall not hold the position of K, or who has not held the position of KMP of the holding company, subsidiary company, associate company in any of the 3 financial years immediately preceding the financial year in which his appointment is being proposed. So, by and large, the provisions are there in the Companies Act. In fact, it includes holding company, subsidiary company, associate company also. But here there is a reference of a listed company. But, and also the reference to the employees of promoter group. There is a proviso which is included to the Companies Act, and that has created a bit of confusion or some more interpretation for the purpose of this particular aspect. But what they are saying is, say, take an, like, now I'll tell you the practical applicability or practical application of this provision. Suppose there is a CFO as on date in a listed company. He resigns today, and tomorrow he says, I would like to be an independent director. It is not possible. The reason is because he was a KMP. Now there should be 3 years cooling off for him, and then he can be an independent director. Same applies to the company secretary, or same applies to the CEO, or same applies to the whole time director of a listed company. That is how the KMPs will be. You can say KMPs after a cooling period of 3 years can be an independent director in the company. However, please understand, they can always be a non-executive director in the company, but not an independent director. For independent director, you need to go through the cooling period of 3 years. Now, let's come to what is something more which SEBI has suggested. One of the very important things which SEBI has suggested is that they have proposed a dual approval mechanism for appointment and removal of independent directors. Presently, what happens by the board of directors? Then he is appointed as an independent director subject to the approval of the shareholders in the annual general meeting. Okay. And then there is a reference to, you can say, So there is a reference to an additional director, then a director, and then he is appointed as an independent director. Okay. So that is how the structure is there when it comes to the present structure. Okay. Later on, if he is to be reappointed, then at the time of reappointment, there is a requirement of a special resolution, which is suggested by the company. Okay. Now, therefore, at the time of appointment, you need an ordinary resolution. And at the time of removal, you need a special resolution. Okay. So when it comes to removal, SEBI has also amended this part and said that when you are appointing or when you're removing an independent director, when you're removing an independent director, at that point of time, you need to, if it is appointed for the first time, then you need to remove it by an ordinary resolution. And if it is there by, you can say, a reappointment, then you need a special resolution for his removal. Now, SEBI is changing all this. They're saying you need one voting process, single voting process, in that all shareholders will vote. Okay. And in that, you will be having a separate part where majority of minority will be considered. So you'll be having two votes, all 100%. And when you say majority of minority, here the minority is non-promoters. So non-promoters will vote. Okay. Non-promoters means who are not running the company as a promoter. So individual retail shareholders, or we can say non-promoters broadly, means not related to the promoters. Therefore, the concept of promoter and promoter group is important. Anybody other than promoter and promoter group will be considered as a minority. And that minority you have considered majority. And that is how the voting will take place, and that is how they will be appointed. And therefore, you have got a dual approval approach, for the purpose of appointment of independent directors. This is a very important aspect which SEBI has introduced. From a practice perspective or from a compliance perspective, this process is a very cumbersome process. The reason is because they're making it a bit difficult for appointment of a company secretary, appointment of an independent director. It's not that very simple. You have to ensure that you go to the shareholders, take the approval, and then only starts working as an independent director, right? Presently, what's the structure? You first appoint him as an independent director subject to the approval of the shareholders. Then before shareholders, you lay down the proposal, then you take the approval. Now the board should be on their toes when it comes to the appointment of the independent director. Okay. And again, obviously with respect to the removal, but removal is a very rare process. Yeah. The procedure to be followed by NRC, there is a detailed procedure that they have to follow by the NRC. There is a prior approval of shareholders for appointment of independent director that we have already seen. Resignation has become more critical. Now, what they are saying is, when it comes to the resignation, basically the entire resignation, his existing preoccupation or, you know, something like prior commitment or personal reason, then the SEBI says, you shall not be a director for next 1 year, independent director in any company. There should be a mandatory cooling period of 1 year. Because you are saying all this preoccupation and other commitments. SEBI wants a very genuine reason why you are resigning. Now, why, there is always, you know, a thought that why is SEBI making all this very difficult? That why is SEBI making this, you know, appointment difficult and resignation difficult? But actually, I feel that appointment to some extent is correct and resignation is correct because you have invested so much efforts in appointing an independent director and the next day he says, okay, I'm resigning because of personal reason. So SEBI is saying that, okay, then you will be punished a bit if you are resigning for personal reason. Now, there is one more point over here, which SEBI has not mentioned. Suppose he is resigning because of health reason. Now, obviously, if it is a health reason, it will obviously personal reason. Now, it could be COVID or it could be anything. But that is not considered. Now, what is health reason? Whether it is a, you know, a personal commitment or a preoccupation or a personal reason, or it could be a genuine reason. So there could be, these are the points of debates, but it will come later on. NRC, I didn't go to that, but NRC is required to find out an appropriate ID, you know, job description required. What is the, you know, the person's profile which is there, whether it is aligning to the company, how he will be able to add the value to the company. All this is to be done by the NRC. Henceforth, that is the proposal which the SEBI has made. This is a funny recommendation. At least I feel it is funny. It says that the audit committee shall comprise of 2/3 of independent director and 1/3 should be NEDs not related to the promoters. Now, practically, if there is a non-executive director not related to the promoter, most of the times he is a independent director, most of the times. But now SEBI says, suppose there are three, committee of three, then two shall be independent, that's fine. This one person should be not related to the promoter. So you can say that all three should be independent directors. That's better to clarify instead of having this kind of part. But anyways, this is one of the proposals which SEBI has made. Interesting part over here is SEBI has said that you can issue ESOPs to independent directors. This is a very rare thing because Companies Act explicitly prohibits issue of ESOPs to the independent directors. It says that ESOP shall not be given. But now they are saying, now understand the reason of ESOP. If, say, TaxCan is giving an ESOP to its employees, it says that the value of TaxCan is going to increase after, say, 4 years. So you be with the company for a period of 4 years. And after that, the company's value will also increase and you will be given shares after 4 years because obviously you have waited for a period of 4 years. So what is this? This is basically a retention policy of a company. Now, the reason that there is a prohibition under the Companies Act for ESOPs for independent directors is only one. That if you are going to retain an independent director, you are going to dilute his independence. Therefore, the Companies Act says it should not be there. But now SEBI is proposing that you can have long-term or long vesting period for the independent directors, and that could be linked to the profit link or in place of profit link commission. So instead of commission, you pay him through ESOPs. That is one way. But let's see how this is proposed, because if this is amended or this proposal is accepted, then the Companies Act would require to be amended for that particular relevant part. So this is all about the two amendments or the two concept papers that have been, or not concept papers, but the consultation papers which SEBI has introduced. So we can come to the questions, because I have seen certain questions which have been raised by the participants. Any question which is there by the?
Yes, there is a question in the chat that we have received.
Yeah.
By Mr. Anup Pandya. He is asking, can executive director be appointed after 3 years as independent director? After he resigns from the KMP, he becomes immediately an executive director, and after the cooling period of 3 years, he has worked as executive director, and during the cooling period, can he be appointed as independent director?
Yeah, so if he has worked as an executive director and then there is a cooling period of 3 years, he can be appointed as an independent director in the company. Because that provision is there under the Companies Act also, and that is specifically in relation to the pecuniary relationship with the company. And when we say an executive director, generally it is the whole time director, and I feel that he can be there as an independent director in the company. Though I need to check SEBI regulations because I don't have quickly the SEBI regulations to refer. But I feel that that could be done for the appointment of independent directors. Actually, I have opened the chat, but I am not able to see the question. Okay. There is one question by Anup. Okay. That has been just answered. Okay. Any other question which is there from any other participant, or any other participant is willing to ask any question, that they can ask a question. Yeah. There is a suggestion, or there is a comment by Mr. B.K. Subramaniam, sir, that it is an excellent proposal of KMP or relative of KMP to not be an independent director, because it is it has been an experience of SEBI. What has happened is the CFO has resigned, and next the CFO is appointed in the company as the independent director. And then the proxy advisory firms and maybe few other investors have raised a question with respect to the part. Okay. Yeah, cooling period to be commenced after resignation of independent. Yeah. Yes. Means like, just let's go by dates. Like, for example, there is a resignation today on 5th of June 2021. After that, 3 years. And after that, I can be appointed. But generally, in the case of executive directors, they have got a notice period to serve. And in certain big companies, the notice period is generally 3 to 6 months. So suppose if my notice period gets over in the month of December, considering that I am an executive director, in that case, my 6 months, but the 3 months, 3 years will start from the end of December, which is the after the resignation. But what you say is correct. No, cooling period to be commenced after resignation. Yeah, that is correct. Yeah. So any other question or any other, point which is there that maybe I would have skipped, or considering the time, I may have not considered in detail.
So Mr. Anup Pandya has asked for an audio option. Let me see if I can enable it from here.
Okay.
Not getting the settings. Mr. Abdullah, are you still there? Can you?
Gauru sir, you are the host now. You can allow him to
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Just go to participant option.
There's an option.
Okay.
He's raised the hand.
Okay. Yes or no? Yeah.
Gaurav, I just wanted to give you the dates which you have just now given an example. A person was appointed, has resigned as CFO of the company on 1st January 2018. He cannot be appointed, he can be appointed immediately after that as an executive director, but he cannot be appointed as an independent director within three years period, cooling period. Now what I think is he is appointed on 2nd of January 2018 as executive director. Then the cooling period would commence only after the 3 years would get over on 2nd of January 2021. Am I correct?
Got it. So basically, first he was a CFO and now he is an executive director.
Yeah, immediately second day after he resigns from the post of CFO. He becomes an executive director.
Correct. So
So CFO is also in KMP and executive director is also KMP. I just wanted.
Correct. Yes. Got it. So yeah. So he's resigning as CFO, then become an executive director, and now you are saying that we want to propose to appoint him as independent director.
Yeah, January 2021.
Yeah. So that is difficult because he is already having a pecuniary relationship with the company. Pecuniary relationship means monetary or financial transactions with the company as a executive director. And therefore, there is a restriction of the cooling period and which is there in the Companies Act. Maybe I'll check it in the SEBI regulations, but this kind of restriction is there. And he will not be eligible to be appointed as a independent director, because now I've understood the question. I thought earlier he was just resigning as CFO and now he proposed to get appointed as a independent director. But the restriction is there and the cooling period compliance would be required. Post executive director.
Yeah, would commence from 2nd of January 2021, 3 years then.
Yeah, correct. Okay. Correct.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Dear attendees, kindly let us know if you have any question. You can either type your question in the chat or you can raise your hand to ask it via audio.
Yeah, actually, if there are not many questions, then there is only two things that may take place. First is that either the session has been so good that there are no questions, or the session has been so confusing that if at all even if they ask a question, then it is not going to get resolved. So just on a lighter note, that probably that could be the situation.
Yes, sir. So.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so thank you, TaxCan, for the invitation. And thank you, members, for your participation. I look forward for your support and more interaction with you all over a period of time.
Thank you.